So first of all, Elon apparently had some time to kill on the 17th of January. We wonder what he was doing while he wrote all those tweets. But there were some highly interesting ones regarding our future on Mars. So we have to talk about the tweets in detail. Then the Starlink satellite count now has increased to 175 after the last successful launch.
And of course, the successful and amazing Crew Dragon in-flight abort test, which basically now paved the way for crewed flights to the ISS. And then another fascinating exoplanet has been discovered. Now, why is it so fascinating, you might ask? Quite simple, because it's in the nearest star system, only 4.2 light years away. Oh yeah, and there's more and more evidence mounting that dark energy might not exist after all. It might be just a mere
illusion. Just an illusion.
Something that I've been saying for years now. I don't want to brag or anything, but no one ever listens to me. So stay tuned for all these amazing news.
So it was one of those rare days when Elon was apparently a bit bored, probably while sitting on the toilet. On the 17th of January, Elon went for berserk on Twitter. And some of his tweets were highly interesting regarding how the colonization of Mars is going to happen, how much it will cost, how many people will live there, and how a Mars colony actually will look like. Plenty of stuff, so let's go through it. First of all, Elon says he's accumulating riches on Earth in order to make humanity multiplanetary, something which we of course already knew. Elon has a giant vision and is not your typical billionaire, but he really cares about the future of humanity and really wants to make it happen, using lots of his own funds for that goal. Then someone asked, how exactly will he want to colonize Mars? With the launch window to Mars arising only every 26 months for around 30 days. To which Elon replied that 1,000 starships would depart every 26 months over the duration of 30 days. It will look like Battlestar Galactica. 1,000 starships in 30 days, so around 33 per day. That's quite a lot of starships. Elon also adds that each starship will have a lifetime of 20 to 30 years. Interesting also, how will people afford to go to Mars? Elon often cited the $100,000 figure. That's how much a trip to Mars should maximally cost. People will be able to take a loan and pay off the loan over time by working on Mars. Elon also adds there will be indeed a lot of work on Mars, for example in propellant production. Now let's analyze all this intriguing information. We all know that Starship runs on liquefied methane and oxygen. Both can be produced on Mars. Oxygen easily by electrolytically breaking up water, which is plentiful on Mars, as we now know. And methane by the Sabatier reaction. Therefore, we will see gigantic propellant production facilities on Mars. And there will be indeed a lot of job offerings in this field.
Now, of course, we assume we'll have some fancy titles for these jobs, such as propellant systems engineer supervisor, or propellant facility chief executive operating officer, or other fancy titles like these, because, you know, nowadays everything needs to have a fancy title. Anyway, back on topic, this is what Elon understands more than any other person. In order to make humanity really a multiplanetary species, we must create an economy on Mars, an economic incentive to go there. Because without an economy, there is no financial incentive. And without financial incentive, nothing will happen. Take for example the gold rush of the 1840s, which basically completely opened up the West. Before that, it was really slow progress, if any at all, but then suddenly everyone wanted to go to the West, and the West became industrialized in an extremely short period of time. And that's in our opinion exactly what will happen on Mars. There will be huge financial and economical benefits of living and working on Mars. So many new industries can be created there. Propellant production is, by the way, only one of many. We will need, for example, a lot of habitat experts, boring tunnel experts for digging the underground bases, then lots of doctors, psychologists, botanists, physicists, of course, because we are always needed everywhere. And then geologists, of course, also, or should we call them Marsologists? Or power plant engineers? So many different job opportunities there, it's mind-boggling. It will be a gigantic, completely new economy. And we all know that economic growth is always the fastest when we start from zero, from scratch, when there's nothing there. There will be a completely new economy growing there with so many amazing new offshoot technologies, for example, that can make life better here on Earth, which we cannot even begin to imagine. Now, it will really be like the Blade Runner blimp advertisement already told us 40 years ago.
A new life awaits you in the off-world colony. The chance to begin again in a golden land of opportunity and adventure.
And we cannot wait to see it happen, hopefully with our own eyes. And I myself might apply as a systems engineers executive officer of...
With the giant 1,000 Starship fleet, Elon wants to see 1 million people live on Mars by 2050. Now that might sound insane to you, but we think it would be doable if SpaceX can ramp up their Starship production, which they probably can achieve by the mid-2020s, thanks to our beloved huge Starlink revenue stream that will be kicking in by then. Elon said SpaceX will build 100 Starships per year, so 1,000 in 10 years, which would mean 100 megatons to orbit per year. Quite some insane numbers. But he said these numbers are needed in order for us to really become multiplanetary. A big economy needs to be created on Mars. That's what Elon understands. And that's why we need so many people on Mars. That's why we have to have so many starships to get the 100 megatons per year into orbit, or the 100k people to Mars in every Mars launch window. This surely sounds insane right now. But let's just think how insane it would have sounded 20 years ago, that Tesla would now be selling hundreds of thousands of electric cars, soon millions, completely driving the legacy car makers to the brink of collapse. Wouldn't that have sounded insane 20 years ago? This is exponential growth, not linear growth. Therefore, we think 1 million people on Mars by 2050 is doable, as insane as it sounds right now. Exponential growth, my friends, exponential. We also want to briefly mention the successful deployment of the latest batch of the Starlink satellites on the 7th of January. Everything went flawlessly. A picture-perfect landing of the Falcon 9 booster on the drone ship. And now the number of Starlink satellites in orbit has increased to 175. Complete coverage of North America by the end of 2020. Twice NASA's annual budget by 2025, enabling Elon's 1,000 Starship plan. That's why Starlink is so important.
And now finally to the successful Crew Dragon in-flight abort test. Wow, 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 what an amazing event that was. Now, we were hoping, of course, with all our hearts that SpaceX would nail this critical test, and they did. Everything went as planned, and the Crew Dragon landed safely in the Atlantic Ocean, while the Falcon 9 booster died in dragonfire, as Elon formulated it nicely. But the sacrifice of the Falcon 9 booster was 100% worth it, because this was the last crucial test needed before crewed missions to the ISS will start. Look, Boeing, this is how it's done. Look over to SpaceX, and they do it with even less money. Yes, yes, with far less money. And now we really cannot wait to see the first crewed launch of a Falcon 9 with Crew Dragon, hopefully in the second quarter this year.
Now a bit on some highly interesting new discoveries. Turns out, with a high probability, another planet exists in the nearest star system, the Proxima Centauri system, which lies only 4.2 light years away. So only 40 trillion kilometers away. Now we know since 2016 that a planet only slightly more massive than Earth, with 1.3 Earth masses, circling Proxima Centauri, which is an M-type dwarf star, a lot smaller, cooler, less massive and less bright than our Sun. So now, a lot of data indicates that another planet, a so-called super-Earth, six times as massive as Earth, which is called Proxima C, exists there too. Unfortunately, Proxima C circles Proxima Centauri very far away. So it's a frozen ice world, where life isn't possible. Proxima B, however, lies in the habitable zone, and could have the right temperatures for liquid water. However, Proxima Centauri, being an M-type dwarf star, has extremely aggressive eruptions, so powerful that it could probably strip the atmosphere of Proxima B. But this is still not proven yet. So we really have to point the James Webb Space Telescope as soon as possible towards the Proxima Centauri system and see what kind of atmosphere, if any, Proxima B has. And of course, if there are more planets in this system besides Proxima B and C.
And now a bit of space stuff, which we normally don't talk so much about, but we thought this is a highly fascinating topic. Now, if you're interested in the universe and fascinated by the universe as much as we are, then you certainly might have read or heard about the so-called dark energy. Now, this is a construct that physicists came up with to explain an observation from 1998 when it was supposedly discovered that the universe is expanding faster and faster, so that the expansion of the universe is accelerating more and more. Now, this discovery was based on the observation of so-called Type 1a supernovae. This is a type of supernovae where white dwarf stars explode, and it was always thought that these supernovae have the same brightness wherever they occur, so they can be used as a standard candle. And this discovery was a complete surprise to cosmologists back then, which now had to come up fast with a solution. But now cosmologists, being what they are, namely physicists, so being lazy, and believe me, I speak from personal experience, they then simply postulated the existence of a mysterious force field which they called dark energy to make sense of these observations. Now this dark energy would make up 70% of all the energy in the universe. 70%. And they had no idea what it is, and they still haven't. You know, a mysterious force field, kind of like the force, you know? It surrounds us. It binds us. It's in the stone there. Sorry, I got carried away. So yeah, they were lazy and just postulated the existence of dark energy to explain this observation in order to save the antiquated model on which our current understanding is based on, the so-called standard model of cosmology. Now, this standard model of cosmology is, by the way, based on 100 years old physics. And there are a few assumptions in this standard model of cosmology which never have been tested yet. Something which, by the way, will change very soon with the upcoming Euclid satellite mission, a mission which I personally am looking forward very much to. But more on that topic another time. I've always been a skeptic of dark energy. I never accepted it. It felt wrong. It always seemed like a lazy construct to me, which only existed because physicists don't like new models. They like to keep their old models working as long as possible. Well, this could change now, because more and more problems keep surfacing in the last years with the discovery from 1998, for which the discoverers, by the way, got the Nobel Prize of Physics. Now, last year in November, for example, the same observation of Type 1a supernovae, so those supernovae that can be used as standard candles because they supposedly have the same brightness everywhere, was repeated by a team of physicists from Oxford, the Institute of Astrophysics in Paris, and the Niels Bohr Institute in Copenhagen. But this time with a much larger data set of 740 instead of the only 60 Type 1a supernovae from back in 1998. So a data set more than 10 times larger than the one from 1998. And surprise, with this new larger data set, they didn't find evidence of an accelerated expansion of the universe anymore. Now, this means that the discovery from 1998 could have been a statistical fluke because they only used 60 Type 1a supernovae, a data set which is quite small. But there's more. Another team from the Yonsei University in South Korea, together with Lyon University, released a new study of Type 1a supernovae, where it turns out their brightness may actually vary after all. Quite a lot actually over time. But the whole discovery of 1998 was based on the assumption that type 1a supernovae have a constant brightness, have the same brightness everywhere. So if their brightness actually varies a lot over time, you cannot use them as standard candles to measure the distance anymore. So quite a few problems are beginning to mount for the dark energy model, and I personally have always been of the opinion that this model will soon join the other models which turned out to be wrong, like for example the ether theory from back in the 19th century, which was by the way proven wrong by the famous Michelson-Morley experiment and paved the way for Einstein's famous breakthrough work of special relativity.
So what do you say to Elon's barrage of tweets? Quite some amazing food for thought, right? We really think that you do need so many people for a functioning economy on Mars by 2050. So what job will you apply for on Mars?
Make sure it contains either the word officer or manager in it. That's very important for the self-esteem, okay?
We will be the video propaganda managers.
Exactly. And what do you think about the dark energy stuff? Are you on my side thinking that this is a mere illusion? A mere illusion based on a wrong idea, a wrong outdated model? Let us know what you think in the comment section.
I'm always on your side.
That's good to know.
And if you're new to this channel, be sure to click the subscribe button because we upload 2 videos per week on spaceflight, electric cars and other amazing new technologies.
So then, see you next time.
See you!